So yeah, we're trying to identify, if you like, a set of dynamics that hopefully help corporates make better decisions around the right partners. The other factor, of course, is understanding the detail behind that. So the 9-grid is very much a top-level assessment. It's a single visual. It has loads of data behind it. We obviously have a public research process, then some deeper research process, what we call our corporate research network. Our customer is typically a European headquartered or based company. Quite often they're multinational. Obviously the very big ones are all very multinational, but they are typically headquartered or based here. So what we're trying to understand is what's relevant to them. So we're tracking a lot of organizations, but we're looking for ones that are relevant to that audience. We're looking for ones, obviously, therefore, with established presence within the sort of customer demographic that we're looking for, and we're looking for the innovator players that potentially could establish that. That's a bit more of a bet. The key thing to understand is that vendors can't buy their way onto it. It needs to be somebody that we see as relevant to that target corporate audience. So the main thing is, you know, who their target customer type is, some kind of track record. Even if they're an innovator player, we want to see maybe some examples where they can show relevance around it, but they have a potential to create a more transformational story. And then obviously when we then assess them, then we look at where they end up getting positioned. It's a little bit based on how that is. It's hard to push right on a 9-grid, you know, to have higher performance unless you've got success through the cycle. So which that means is, you know, customer awareness of you, you're appearing in a buying cycle on the corporate side, you're winning business clearly, and then you're able to deliver it and drive customer advocacy. So the performance dimension of a 9-grid is based around that as a sort of serial proposition. So if you're just an innovator player, obviously you may show, you'll only show a limited amount of customer awareness by definition. Most people won't be aware of you, but you might show really good customer outcomes, but only in a narrow set of scenarios. So actually that obviously tends to mean that they appear more left on the left side of the model. And as they maybe generate more momentum, they'll move right. And it's a banded structure. So you can't have everybody in the top right, okay? It's just not a possibility. If everybody moves right, then effectively the bands reshift. So you'll always have people that are higher, mid and lower. So performance potential. So the performances, as I've just described, is around, you know, customer awareness through to buying behavior, through to delivery and advocacy. Potential is about their ability to serve the needs of that customer demographic. So again, you see organizations banded a little bit there. You know, whilst all the vendors tend to see themselves as being an enterprise class supplier, in reality, very few of them really are. They would struggle to deal with real multinational organizations and so on. And that's not just about product capability. So that's a differentiating factor, clearly. You know, do you have the sophistication in your product to deal with a complex organization? But it's also about their capability as an organization, their service teams, their, you know, support to languages or companies that are driving it in other geographies. So the enterprise-ness of it, some cases, is a key factor. And then ultimately there are other factors as well. So the total cost of ownership. One of the things we really want organizations to think about is not just where do I want to be, but what can I afford to pay for it? I think that trade-off is not really very well understood by organizations. They think about it a little bit in terms of license price, but not really around the cost for them to really own, operate, and innovate that platform afterwards. And that should be a big driver of outcome. I mean, if you can find the right fit for you at the right value proposition or cost proposition, that actually makes an awful lot of sense, rather than just trying to buy the things with the most bells and whistles and then not really having the resources or the investment to be able to really deliver it in any successful way. That's driven a lot of some of those older things like LMS failures and so on, is where people bought up at a level in the market, but frankly, it didn't fit what their needs really were, and they didn't have the resources to do it. So yeah, total cost of ownership, market presence in general, and then the final factor we look at is what we call trajectory, which is, so that's one of the things that often gets organizations tripped up a little bit. Where they appear in a box, in a nine grid, what we call a zone, is not based on a relative view of those vendors, it's based on the trajectory of that vendor. So, and that's relatively largely to themselves and the market as a whole. So, you know, if we position somebody in the top right part of a zone, what that says is they're accelerating. You know, they're accelerating their potential and probably their performance trajectory relative to where they were. It's quite hard to keep doing that. I mean, you know, even an organization that's growing like that will probably be maintaining it, not accelerating. And accelerating means it's going up.